As we prepare to hear God's word read and proclaimed, let us pray. Holy God, on this Christmas night, as we prepare to hear again the story of Christ's birth, we pray that you would open our hearts and touch our souls with this great good news. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Our reading tonight comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Like many others this fall, I fell in love with two Netflix series about queens, The Crown and The Queen's Gambit. The Crown follows the reign of Queen Elizabeth II, dramatizing historical events. The fourth season, released this fall, covers the 1970s and 80s, when Margaret Thatcher became Britain's first female prime minister, and Prince Charles married Diana Spencer, who became the Princess of Wales. The Queen's Gambit tells the story of a chess prodigy named Beth Harmon, who was orphaned at 9 years old and sent to a home for girls, where she learned chess from the janitor and developed an addiction to tranquilizers. Despite their differences, both The Crown and The Queen's Gambit are actually about the same thing, and it's not queens. It's family. Both ask us to consider what makes a family. What does it mean to be family? And what do we do when our families disappoint us? We gather this evening to celebrate not just the birth of Jesus, but God's new creation of the human family. Jesus was born into a family of the usual sort, which is to say, a family that was more than a little messy and which brought together some unexpected members. Jesus' cousin was John the Baptist, a wilderness preacher who wore animal skins, ate locusts and wild honey, and announced the coming of the Messiah. Jesus' parents were Mary, who became unexpectedly pregnant, and Joseph, who agreed to still marry her even though the baby wasn't his. But tonight is the night we learn there is more to this family than blood and promises, because the story we heard tells us that on this night, the angel announced Jesus' birth to a group of shepherds in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Most of us are so familiar with this story and its many depictions in literature and art and nativity sets that we fail to realize how remarkable it is that the angel appears to shepherds At that time, shepherds were some of the lowliest members of society. They tended to be poor and illiterate. Because they often grazed their flocks on other people's property, they were viewed as dishonest. Along with sailors, butchers, and camel drivers, shepherds were the outcasts of polite society. Yet it is shepherds to whom the angel announces the birth of the Christ child. And the angel does more than just sing this news in a blaze of angelic glory, but also invites the shepherds, these outcasts, to be part of this new family born this night. To you, yes, even to you, the angel says, is born this day a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. And if to the lowly shepherds, then indeed to us all. By including shepherds in this family, it is as if God announces, behold, you, all of you, are family. You are on the same team. You belong to one another. And I am with you to bring you and hold you together. A couple of fraught years into Charles and Diana's marriage, they went on a tour of Australia and New Zealand, taking along their infant son, William. In the episode of The Crown that dramatizes this event, we see the tour get off to a rocky start, but it becomes a resounding success as huge, adoring crowds show up wherever the royal couple goes. At one point during the tour, Charles and Diana have a heart-to-heart that gets them past their conflicts. But by the end, their relationship has once again deteriorated. And as soon as they return to England, Charles goes back to his mistress. Depressed but determined, Diana requests a meeting with the Queen to tell her she's struggling and to ask for her help.
Because since I've joined this family, it's not been easy. I've been given no help, no support, just thrown in the deep end, and I think that people out there can sense that I've suffered, that I'm undervalued, ignored.
I think it's a mistake to assume that people are feeling any sympathy for us at all.
And I think it's a mistake to assume they don't. You've seen how the crowds responded to me in Australia, here too, and instead of resenting me for it...
I assure you, no one resents you.
Charles resents me. Anne resents me, and is it possible that you resent me too? All I want is to play for the team.
You're the Princess of Wales, so of course you're part of the team.
Then show me. This whole thing, it starts and stops with you. You're the captain of the team. If you show me love, approval, and acceptance, everyone else will follow.
I think we've gone as far as we can. For now, we can continue another time.
Oh, don't dismiss me, please. Don't push me away.
What?
Mama. That's all I want. It's all any of us want from you. Is it too much to ask?
Although she is a newcomer to this royal family, Diana knows how families work. It is the head of the family who sets the tone. You're the captain of the team, Diana tells the Queen. If you do it, the rest will follow. But at least in matters of family relationships, the Queen is reluctant to accept that role and responsibility. Not so the King of Kings, whose birth we celebrate this night, our God, who, born to peasants in a forgotten corner of the world, reveals a new kind of power and glory. In Jesus, we learn that God's strength, true strength, is revealed not in political power or military might, but in vulnerability and compassion, in the recognition that human beings, that we, need one another. Jesus' life reveals to us God's expansive embrace of the world by redefining family. Beginning with the shepherds and continuing throughout Jesus' ministry with the disciples and all those on the margins with whom he spends his time, Jesus teaches us that no matter who we are, we belong in this family. We belong to each other. If the crown's depiction of Diana's reception, or lack thereof, into the royal family is a lesson in what damage is done when we reject the outsider, the queen's gambit offers the opposite lesson: what can be achieved when we show up for one another, even and especially the marginalized and the suffering. In the Queen's Gambit, Beth Harmon becomes a great chess player because she is brilliant and talented. But she becomes a champion because of all the people who help her along the way. The janitor and her friend Jolene at the orphanage, her adoptive mother in Kentucky, a series of mentors she meets in various competitions. But every time Beth gets close to someone, her discomfort with vulnerability and the unprocessed grief and trauma she carries leads her to reject relationships and seek refuge in pills and alcohol. After winning the U.S. championship, Benny, the player she defeated for the title, offers to help Beth prepare for the next big tournament in Paris, but only if she stops drinking. After weeks as Benny's student, Beth goes to Paris and makes it to the final match against the Russian world champion. But the night before, she succumbs to her addiction and then loses the match. Back home in Kentucky, she is rescued from a days-long bender when Jolene shows up, helps her get sober, and lends her the money to go to Moscow to play for the title of world champion. At this point, Beth has alienated all the players who helped her along the way, and she travels to Moscow alone. In match after match with the Russian greats, she sees that what Benny told her was true. The Russians win because they play together as a team. They help each other out. Us Americans, Benny had told her, we work alone because we're all such individualists. We don't like to let anyone help us. Amazingly, in the tournament, Beth keeps winning, and in the final round, again, faces the Russian champion who beat her in Paris. Their match goes on for so long, they have to adjourn overnight. This is when Beth is at her most vulnerable, most likely to give in to her addiction. But on her way to her hotel room, Beth runs into Towns, one of her former competitors and friends who was a casualty of her fierce independence. "What are you doing here?" she asks him. But even before he answers, it's clear he's come to support her, having moved mountains to get himself there. Her relief is overwhelming. A friend she was sure she had lost has found her just when she needed him most. The next morning, Towns wakes Beth so she can prepare for the rest of the match. Then the phone rings.
Hello?
If he goes for the knight, hit him with the king rook pawn.
Benny?
If he goes for the bishop, do the same thing, but open up your queen file.
How do you know?
It's in the Times. 7 a.m. here, but we've been working on it for 3 hours.
Hi, Beth.
Hi, Harry. It's really nice to hear your voice.
Oh, hang on.
Hey, Harry!
It's
Mike! We're so proud of you.
Okay, there are three things you might do now. So after the queen to knight 3, you play knight to king 6. Then if he plays rook to rook 5, then you play pawn to king 3. Another variation, if he plays knight...
In the birth of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, a helpless baby greeted by stable animals and shepherds, we learn that again and again, God transcends time and space to show up for us, to draw alongside us in the mess and muck and mire of our lives, to remind us that no matter how much it feels like we have lost at the game of life, we too have a place in this human family, the family God brings together, a family of winners and losers, royals and peasants, insiders and outsiders, all of us infinitely and unconditionally loved by the God of the universe. The announcement to the shepherds is for all of us. To you is born this night a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. With these words, we become family, whoever we are. And this is not just an announcement, but an invitation. For the members of this family are not defined by our differences. In this family, God's family, we all play for the same team. Despite all the ways we hurt and betray and reject one another, and we do this again and again in a myriad of ways, we are invited by the head of our family to draw alongside one another, to show up for one another, to be vulnerable with one another about our fear and our grief and our need, and to respond to one another with compassion and love. Christmas is when we learn again, no matter what, God shows up for us. As we gaze at the child born for a broken and hurting world, may we find the courage to show up for each other. Amen.